Thank you. It's steadfast, it's sure, it's able to do what God sent it to do. So I'm going to challenge you this morning as we reach into the Word of God, as we break the bread of life. Amen. This Word will heal, it will deliver, it will sanctify, and it will cause peace in the middle of the storm. And I want you to find it, because the Word of God says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. We'll never find it in the things of man. Because you faith is the substance of those things hoped for, but the evidence of those things not yet seen. So let's just let go this morning. And let's let God fill us with that love, fill us with that peace, as we break open the Word of God. You believe, I believe that God is reaching out with compassion right now. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. I believe God is reaching out to us with compassion this morning. And I'm going to speak this morning about having compassion. You see, compassion is not something on the outside. Compassion is something that first happens in the inward side. It's an inward emotion or it's conviction that compels us to do something outwardly. And that God wants to compel you to reach into this world right now, because God's not giving us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. He wants to strengthen you in the middle of the storm. But he also wants to tell you, we're not fighting flesh and blood, but we're fighting principalities and power. Those powers are the powers of influence. The Bible said in Genesis 3, the devil was more subtle or more deceptive than any creature. He's trying to deceive this generation and tell us that God is not enough. But I want to tell you, God is the rock of our salvation. In the middle of this storm, it's God that's reaching in with compassion. And he's healing the land. He's sending us leaders to lead us through this storm that are leading us not into the wilderness, but leading us to the promised land. Amen. We don't want that generation that died in the wilderness to lead us. But we want that generation that leads us to the land that's flowing with milk and honey. Amen. I know about you, but I feel like something good is getting ready to happen. You know, the Lord gave me a word, a prophetic word in the first year. If you haven't gone online to abundantrain.net and watch it, I challenge you to go there. A plow has hit the ground. And God spoke to me and he said, I'm getting ready to turn everything upside down. And everything's getting ready to be really, really messy. I'm watching the mess all around. But the good thing is when everything gets messy, it means everything is finding something new. So in the middle of the storm, people are analyzing how they've been living, the things that they're doing. And all of a sudden, new things are beginning, and people are beginning to put their time and their effort and their energy in things that are important. One of those things which is important is the kingdom of God. Because the Word of God says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these other things will be added unto us. All we got to do is keep our eyes on God and realize that God is with us. He's anointed us. He's equipped us for such a time as this. In fact, in Matthew 9, 35 through 38, we find that Jesus speaks and he said, Jesus went into all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogue, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and every sickness. And when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to the disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into the harvest field. And he gives us a key right there. Keys are something that unlocks something. Keys are something that you find something in. He says, I've given you the keys to the kingdom. That's what he told Peter. He said, upon this rock, I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. He said, I give you the keys to the kingdom. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And so we find that God says that through works of compassion, we will find the keys to the kingdom. And how is that? We find it through seeking God or asking God in the middle of the storm. I'm so thankful and yes, gratitude for our governor and for the churches that have pulled together and the president of the United States that has called our nation to prayer. To stand in the gap in the middle of the storm. You see, it's God when Jehoshaphat, the enemy, was coming against him. Then he called the same people together and he gathered them around the house of God. And they began to pray. They began to seek God. And God sent a word and said, the battle is not yours, the battle is God. That's what we've got to do. We got to turn this storm around. But the Bible said, cast your care upon me, for I care for you. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. And I'll no way cast you away if you seek me. But he said to him, the harvest is really ripe. That means that there's a great need in the world right now. Amen. And that there's needs workers to go to the field. How many of that God has called us to go into all the world and preach this gospel to every creature? We're not supposed to be walking in the spirit of fear, but God's given us the power and the ability to face the giants in our life. But I think about the story of David and Goliath. I think about how the children of Israel were the chosen people of God. But they were hiding in fear. They were hiding because they were afraid because Goliath was so big and he was so strong and so massive. Well, David comes up, a little shepherd boy, and he sees Goliath down there challenging the children of Israel. And he said to the king, what's going to be done to this guy that's coming up and challenging the kingdom of God? And David looks and they said, well, they were walking in fear. And then they got mad at him. They said, who are you to tell us that we should be doing this or we should be doing that? Saying, you're nothing but a little lad that takes care of the sheep and the flock in the hills. And then David reminded them, said, well, I might be little, but my God is mighty. Come on, somebody. My God is mighty. And when the lion came, I killed the lion. When the bear came, I killed the bear. And I want to tell you something. This Goliath is getting ready to come down too. And God's going to deliver him into my hand. I want to tell you that God is going to deliver us in the middle of the storm. He's going to be doing exactly what he's came to do. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested to destroy the works of the enemy. That is sickness, disease, poverty. Amen. And then God wants you to know he's putting the sense that's free is free indeed. You see, we cannot wait till the battle is over to do something for God. We can't wait until and ride the victory on everybody else's shoulders. But every one of us, no matter where we're at, I know that they're saying some businesses are essential and some businesses are unessential. And those essential, he says, those are your frontline people. Keep them working. Keep them doing things. Amen. But I want to talk a little bit about the unessential. The ones that they say that are not valuable in this season. And I'm going to tell you, with God, everyone is valuable. Everyone is important. And every one of us are going through seasons that we might be on the front line or we might be the ones supporting the front line. I believe there's people on the front line. There's people that are making the supplies for the front line. And there are those that are standing in the gap and praying and interceding and getting God's favor in the middle of the storm. And more are those that are praying and seeking God. And they are probably the most valuable people in the middle of the storm. You see, and I tell you that God is calling you, amen, to this battle. Amen. Not to sit back, but intervene and not be afraid, but begin to do what God has called you to do in the middle of the storm. Do what you can do. And I'm going to say that because we're feeding last week. We fed around 350 families that we sent out to 13, 14 different communities and sending out food, sending out provision. And you know what? We put online, we need certain things that we don't have for our frontline people. And I want to thank God that one of our members of our church family, she made these little breathing deals that you can put over your ears for our workers that come together. Amen. They sack our food. Amen. Because we have to assemble all this food. Amen. And pray with these people and give them the provision that God has given us. Many of the things that we have. I know his storehouse is a place of refuge. It's a place that people come to in the time of trouble. Another one came and gave me an air mask. Amen. He said, this is only one. I said, well, one is better than none. Praise the Lord. That's one person that can work the front line because you chose to give and not sit back. He could have kept it for himself, but he realized, he said, I'm not out there on the front line. I'm sitting at home, amen, and I'm praying and I'm interceding, but I'm going to join the supply line. And I think it's so important that we realize and recognize how important that supply line and those people that they call are unessential. And when I talk about that this morning, I'm going to talk about David. David in 1 Samuel 30 and 6. David had been in battle and took all his army and all his men out to battle. And they had been out there and God was defeating the enemy. But while they were gone, the enemy came around. Two kings came around and stole all their wives and stole all their provision. They lost everything while they were fighting the battle. Amen. But I want to tell you that David came back and the men came back and the men wanted to kill David. In fact, let's read it. 1 Samuel 31 says, and David, 30 and 6 says, and David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of the people was grieved, and every man for his sons and his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord. It's so important for us to realize that greater is he that is in us than him that's in the world. Even though the enemy comes in like a flood, God will always raise up a standard. We don't understand the things that we're going through. Many times bad things happen to good people. But it's not that situation in that one moment that dictates what's going to happen. What dictates what's going to happen is how your faith is going to react when the storms of life come. Because even in that moment, you have to make a decision whether you're going to move forward or whether you're going to go backward. Whether you're going to hibernate or whether you're going to believe God for more. You see, faith is believing that God is the substance of all things hoped for. That God is bigger than my problems. He's bigger than my fears. And David began to encourage himself by seeking God and putting himself in remembrance of all the things that God has brought him through. Think about how many things that we have to be thankful for. I'm thankful for America. I'm thankful for our provision that we have in our country. I'm thankful that we can face the giant better than any country or any nation in the world. I'm thankful that our people, like when Pearl Harbor got bombed, all the factories started turning and making the army and making the military equipment that was needed to fight the battle. Mothers began to start sewing garments together, putting things together to put on our soldiers. That's those people that they think are unessential, but yet they were as important as every person on the front line. Because if they didn't have the supply line, they could never fight the battle. I want to tell you, church, we are important to the kingdom of God. For God has chosen you for such a time as this. This is the hour in the middle of the mess that God is the light in the middle of the storm. Just like he was in the beginning when everything was confused and empty and void, God stepped in and began to speak faith. So we've been called to speak faith in the middle of the storm and believe God is more than enough to quiet the mouth of the lion, present the mouth of the lion, quiet the storms that we're facing and bring healing to the land. How many of y'all excited about the healing in the land? And David began to encourage himself. Then he challenged the people, and he said to the people, God is with us. Let's go and recover our wives. Let's recover what we've lost. Are you hearing me? Many of us have lost a lot of things, but we have a lot of things still valuable around us that are very important. And God is challenging us to go fight the enemy and to go into battle. Not to back up, but challenge us to step forward by making the necessary things needed and the things that we can do to cause this war to become effective. I'm thankful for all those that are making sacrifices right now in America, around the world, that we might wage this war against this virus. But I got news for you. God's already given us the cure. Amen. We're just standing in the gap. We're fighting the battle of faith. But in the end run, the battle is not ours. The battle is God. We're casting our care on God, for God cares for us. The Bible said they went into the army. Amen. And they defeated the army. And when they defeated their army, they took all the spoil, not only their own, but all the spoil that those kings had took all the way across the land. And when they came back, the ones that were too feeble, the ones that were too weak, the ones that people said were unimportant, David, as he was walking up, he saluted them. Are you? In fact, you'll find Exodus 30, verse 21. David greeted them and went to them and spoke how much he appreciated them, standing behind and standing in the gap in the middle of the storm. I'm going to tell you, our president appreciates your prayer and standing in the gap. It's not a time that we need to condemn him, but it's a time that we need to lift him up and lift a banner of praise and thanksgiving over him. It's not a time for us to get mad at everybody else, but to walk in love and love God and love people. It's a time for us to understand that every good gift, every perfect gift comes from God. We don't deserve anything, but yet God has given it to us all. Back up and read this story. 1 Samuel 30, 21-24. David came with 200 men, which were so faint that they could not follow David, who had made also to abide by the brook Besor. And they went forth to meet David and to meet the people that were with him. And when David came near the people, he saluted them. Then he answered all the wicked men of Baal, of those that went with David, and said, because they went not with us, we will not give them aught of spoil that we have recovered, save every man his wife and his children, that they may lead away and depart from us. And then David said, not so. My brethren, with that which is the Lord has given us, who has preserved us and delivered the company that came against us into our hand. For who will hearken unto this matter? But as his part is that he goeth down to battle, so shall his part be that teareth by stuff, and there shall be a part alive, saying we will share equally in the middle of the storm. Come on, somebody. God is asking us to share equally in the battle. And some of us are on the front line serving people. Some of us are on the supply line. And others are like these 200. And we're watching and we're preparing and getting things ready. Giving our finances, giving our time where we can to make a difference in the battle that we're facing. It's so important that we all be involved. But remember this, that God's not a respecter of person, but he's going to reward us all. He said, whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. God loves us all, and it's God's will that none would perish, but that all would have eternal life in Jesus Christ. You see, what is God looking for in the middle of the storm from the church? What is he asking us to do? We find that in Matthew 25, 31-37. And when the Son of Man shall come in glory, and all his holy angels with him, then he shall sit upon the throne of glory, and before him shall be gathered all the nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divided the sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on the right hand, and the goats on the left hand. Then shall say the king, say unto them on the right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom that I prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. What shall the righteous answer unto him? Saying, the Lord, when did I see you hungry, and when did I feed you? When were you thirsty, and when did I give you a drink? He says, onward, he said, when you did it unto the least of one of them, you did it unto me. Praise the Lord. When you give the littlest thing you got, it means a lot. Praise the Lord. I can remember times in my life when I didn't have anything at all and somebody would give me just something little. Today I would look at it and say, that doesn't really have any significance. But I want to tell you, in that moment, that little offering, that little deed that they did, was a significant miracle in my life. It might have just been a sandwich. It might have just been a loaf of bread. It might have just been enough money to buy enough gas, 50 cents in gas, or just enough to get from one place to another place. You see, nothing is insignificant when people are without something. You see, everybody's trash is another man's miracle. And in the middle of the storm, your giftings, your talents, your ability might not be as great as those on the front line. But I want to tell you, you're valuable, because the little insignificant things you have in your storehouse are important to the kingdom of God. And God wants to use you in the middle of this battle, because you are significant in the kingdom of God. We're living in a significant time in the history of humanity. God said, I sent a word. I'm plowing the ground. I'm turning everything over. It'll be more we have not because we ask not. But you are valuable in this church. You are valuable to the community. You are valuable to your family. You are important. Like the Bible says, you're wonderfully and perfectly made of the Lord. And God wants you to know you're so valuable to Him that He gave His only Son to die on the cross. We're coming up on Easter, a time of significance in the church, a time that our Father gave His only Son, that all across the world, people will be celebrating that sacrifice that was given, the blood that was shed, the gift that was given. That gift that He gave us was eternal life in Jesus Christ. And right now I'm telling you, you've got a gift in your hand. God's given gifts to you, and He wants you to share your gift. He wants you to give it to somebody and tell them about the good news. There's somebody out there that's living in despair. As I said in Matthew 9, He went everywhere preaching, teaching, and healing all those that were oppressed of the devil or sickness of the devil. Many, many people are walking in fear right now that need your faith, that need your boldness, that need your testimony. What God has done in your life and how God has took you through the middle of a storm and made you more than a conqueror. I want to tell you this morning that God is with you and He's in the middle of the battle. But what He's looking at for you and I, He's looking to see what we're doing in the middle of the storm. Are we sitting back, hiding in fear? Don't you know who is with you? The King of glory, the I am that I am, Jehovah Jireh, the one that sees ahead and brings provision for you, Jehovah Shalom, the Lord of peace. He's the El Shaddai, the blessed one, able to intervene in the middle of the storm. He's your commander. He's your chief. He's your healer. He's your deliverer. He's your sanctifier. He's refreshing you and renewing you and rekindling you. And God's getting ready to give you a new garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. He said He would guide us, He would lead us into all truth. Amen. God wants a sacrifice from us. What is that sacrifice? We talk about the sacrifice, amen, of abstaining from things and seeking God. Amen. And then God wants you to know this is the type of fast that He's looking for in the middle of the storm. Are you ready? Isaiah 58, 6 to 12. Is this not the fast that I've chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread to the hungry, that you bring the poor to your house that are cast out, and you see him naked, you cover him, and not hide yourself from your own flesh? Then this light shall break forth in the morning, and your healing shall break forth speedily. And your righteousness shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Come on, somebody. You see, it's not in my confession, it's in my outward expression of my testimony. You see, James said, show me your faith, I'll show you my works. You see, works speak about how loudly we believe in something. Works tell us how much we're willing to sacrifice to be what God has called us to be. He said, how can you say you love God when you hate it or you turn away your brother whom you see? But God is telling us to walk in compassion in this hour and reach out to our brother to be what needs to be done, to be the lamb, amen, to pick up our cross and follow him, to enter this storm and realize that greater is he that's with us than him that is in the world. He said, is it fast I've called it? He said, when you do that, your light will break out, your healing will begin to happen speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and he shall say, here am I. You take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing of finger and speaking wickedness. If you extend your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then your light shall shine in the darkness, and your darkness as the noonday. And the Lord will guide you continually, and he will satisfy your soul in the drought. He will strengthen your bones, and you shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters fail will not. Those from among you, you shall build the old waste places. You shall rise up the foundations of many generations, and you shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the streets to dwell in. I'm proud to say, in America, the church always is the first responders to every crisis in the world. All over the world, our planes are full with missionaries that are going all over the world, giving up everything that they have. They're going to the world to preach this good news, to raise up the generation that doesn't live in poverty and doesn't live in sickness, but dwells in the presence of God. These missionaries have sacrificed everything to go on the world. But in the same way we have missionaries to America, we have churches almost on every corner that are preaching the good news. But we're more than just four walls. It's on the outward walls that we find the needs are great and that we need to go into the harvest. But the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Every day we need more equipment. We need more things. Right now, I have so much food that I can get. I can't haul it all. I need trucks. I need forklifts. I need people that stand in the gap. Maybe your business is shut down and you have a truck or you have a forklift or you have something that God can use in the middle of the storm for a period of time. Now let us bring in the resources. You can be the supplier to the front line, and I challenge you to step in the gap and believe God. And when you do, he said your life will break forth and I will recognize you. And when you pray, I will hear you and I will answer you and I will do what you need to have done. In the middle of that storm, Mother Teresa herself said this: love cannot remain by itself. It has no meaning. Love has to be put into action, and that action is service. Love cannot remain in itself. It has no meaning. Love without works has no meaning. You tell me to love people, but you don't love people. You tell me to give, but you don't give. You tell me all these things with your mouth, but your heart is far from me. We say that we're Christians, but we're hiding from what God has called us to do. Every person is a chosen vessel of God, and God has called you. Even in your home, it might be the prayer or studying the Word of God. I thank God my worship leader, John, the one that was up here, all week long, he'd been singing songs on Facebook, trying to encourage people. And I've been watching certain ones, they're bored, they have nothing to do, but rather than watch TV or do something, they're getting on Facebook and talking about God, talking about what God is. They've got to share the gospel because they know that God's the answer in the middle of the storm. I challenge you, get out of your box, do something for God. In 1950, Mother Teresa started a missions of charity in the Roman Catholic congregation. She had over 4,500 nuns before it was over. She lived in the middle of India, the poorest country, one of the poorest countries in the world. She was active in 133 countries. Oh, come on, somebody. In 2012, her congregation managed for people who are dying of HIV, AIDS, leprosy, tuberculosis. She has soup kitchens, dispensaries, mobile clinics, children and family counseling, as well as orphanages and schools. You see, people that join her make a commitment for this. You ready? Members take vows of chastity, poverty, obedience, and to give. Oh. Somebody say that again. They make a commitment to walk in chastity, poverty, obedience, and to give. In 1979, Mother Teresa was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for her work undertaking the struggle to overcome poverty and distress, which also constitutes a threat of peace. She didn't attend the ceremonial banquet that they gave for her to receive the Nobel Prize. And that year they gave her $192,000. But she requested, before they even gave it to her, give the check to the poor. She had nothing but the garments on her back. She said, Job said, naked I came in and naked I'm going out. Blessed be the name of the Lord. She gave her life for the cause of Christ. knowing there was a greater place that was being stored up for her. Jesus said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it weren't so, well, I told you so. But I go away to prepare a place for you." Are you telling me to live a life of poverty? No, not everybody. I believe that God has called us to prosper even as our soul has prospered. But what he has asked us to do is when we have it, to give it. When somebody comes up and has a need, God is asking us to meet that need. I believe we have a crisis in our nation. And it's not a time for us to hide, but it's time for us to come to the front line and start fighting the battle. Maybe your front line is praying and reading the Word of God at home. Maybe your front line is talking to your neighbors and telling them what God has done in your life. The Bible said you're known by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. Maybe your front line is just raising your hands up to God every morning. Say, "Thank you, Jesus, for healing me, delivering me, and saving me. I thank you for the cure for this virus. I thank you that, God, you're more than enough. You said you'd never leave me. You'd never forsake me, but you'd be with me always. You're my healer. You're my deliverer. You're my sanctifier. And my eyes are on you." I challenge you this morning to seek the kingdom of God. Turn from your ways, as it says in Chronicles 8. "If my people that are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and turn from their sin, then my eyes will be upon that place, and then I will heal the land." But his eyes are more than just on those words. His eyes are on your actions. He said, "You confess me with your mouth, but your heart is far from me." And God is calling us to walk in compassion right now and love people. If I was to do what the world said, I would draw back in a shell. I wouldn't touch anybody. But yet, I already knew, and I will tell you, he said, before something happens, God will make it known. God spoke to me and said, "A word is coming and everything's getting ready to be messy. I'm turning everything upside down." But he told me, "Don't get upset, for I am in the middle of the mess. And what man can't do, I'm getting ready to do. And I'm going to turn this to the greatest victory you ever had in your life. We're going to see a spiritual awakening like we've never seen a spiritual awakening. This is going to be called the greatest time of revival in the history of humanity. I don't even know if we'll have another generation that they'll even be able to read the history about what's going to happen. We're going to rewrite a lot of things in history in the next 2 or 3 years. We're going to rewrite American history in the next 2 or 3 years. We're going to raise up a banner greater than the day we became a nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Why? Because God said, "Greater things will I do." But we got to get our eyes on God. And I got to start having faith in God. I got to start speaking to that mountain. He said, "My word is nigh you, even at your mouth." What is that? The word of faith to save your soul. The word has already been given to us. Jesus has already died on the cross. And I got news for you. He's already raised. The Bible said that on the third day, he rolled the stone away. He walked out triumphantly. And for 40 days and for 40 nights, even the graves open and the dead raised. Can you imagine being alive at that time? In Elijah and Moses and Isaiah and Jeremiah, Ezekiel. Can you imagine being alive? Adam, Eve, all coming up out of their graves and start preaching, "He is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life." For 40 days, the dead were being raised. The lame were walking, the blind were seeing. And God was manifesting his power. This is what God said when he went to heaven. "Greater things will you do when I send to the right hand of the Father and I send back my spirit. Greater things will you do than what I did when I was on the face of the earth." This is what God has said to you, and I'm saying it to this generation. You have not seen nothing yet. You can't hide because God is everywhere. He's omnipresent. He knows you're coming in and He knows you're going out. He knows what you're doing and He knows where you're going. You're not hiding, but God is searching you out, not to condemn you. He's searching you out because He wants to draw you unto His bosom and He wants to give you some good gifts. He wants to bless you with every spiritual blessing and He wants to empower you for such a time as this. I never would have dreamed a little ministry in Quito, Oklahoma would be feeding millions of people all over the world. But yet God has given us. And when I ask God, why did you give it to this church? Why? When there's all these churches that have all this money and have all these buildings, why did you give it to us? This is what God said to me. Because you'll do it. Oh, come on, somebody. You want God to give you something? God wants you to do it. Be a doer of a word and not a hearer only. It's time to get busy for God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. How many this morning would say, I need God to intervene in my world. I've got so many storms. I've got things so messed up. My bills are so high. My mom's sick. My dad's sick. My children are running good. Drugs are in alcohol. Drugs are in prison. My whole world's messed up. I don't even talk about it to my friends because it's so bad I don't even want to face it. I cry at night when nobody's around and I mourn and I don't know what's going on. And I say, God! And God's telling you, I'm here. And then I'm going to turn this situation around if you'll just have a little bit of faith in God. And if you'll not doubt, but him that endure the end shall inherit the kingdom of God. God's going to quiet your storm. I want you to pray this prayer with me. In Ephesians, the first chapter, Paul prays this for the body of Christ. Confusion is trying to enter the church, fighting and bickering and mumbling among themselves, much like our nation and our churches today. And Paul says, I pray that the eyes of your understanding be enlightened to the wisdom and the knowledge and the power that God worked when He raised Jesus from the dead. When He set Him high above all principalities and powers and dominions, and gave Him a name above every name. Made Him the head of the church, which is the body of Christ. I pray this morning that the eyes of your understanding be enlightened. I pray this morning that you open up your heart for God to begin to start transforming your life. He is the answer to your problems. And if you ask, God will intervene. God is faithful and He's true to remember what you're going through. Remember this morning. Jesus is Lord. Amen. God bless you. The Johnson House is open. Go down and get some food. Amen. I love you.